whatever, to actually ask the senator to make the introduction. I'll just make some brief comments and sort of actually add to that.
But Representative John Kirby, I've had the pleasure of knowing for quite a while. I did get to serve with him in the House before I was governor. I'd like to go off and become governor just about the time that he was getting there, so I didn't have a chance to serve with him. As I recall, he was born in Salem, Massachusetts, is that true? Okay. And I believe that among the places that are included in his district, the 6th District, are Gloucester and Cape Ann, a bunch of other places. I understand that the issues that are before us today that Senator Brown urges to examine are of great interest to the end. And we're just delighted we could be here. Grateful for your testimony.
Thank you.
I ask you to proceed.
Mr. Chairman, please. Thank you. I just want to say thank you for your effort on this issue. It's something that you and Congressman Frank have been working very hard on, along with Senator Kerry, to try to bring these issues up. And as a result of the congressional hearing we've had, and what we're doing, and what the Congress Committee is doing, hopefully we'll be able to bring this these issues to light and do it better. So thank you, Congressman, for showing up.
Thank you. Thank you both, Chairman Cochran and Member Brown. Frankly, I think most of us don't care how an issue of the jurisdiction had the hearing. We're just pleased that you're focusing some light on this issue. We've been fighting for some time. This has been a bipartisan effort. And Senator Brown, we really welcome your attention to it. We knew when you brought Vito on board that you were really focusing like a laser beam and making sure that we're all on the same page. And I see a lot of familiar faces out in the audience today that were at the hearing that we held in Gloucester about a little over a year ago. I know Mayor Kirk and the Representative Fronte, Senator Tarr, all of the others that have been so involved in this issue. I'm pleased that you're here, and they deserve a large part of the credit for actually inducing Dr. Luchenko to originally ask for Inspector General's report. It took quite a bit of agitation from the community, from elected officials, from people working in the industry to make sure that that happened. I'm disappointed that Dr. Luchenko is not here today, as I'm sure you are. I'm not surprised, unfortunately, given the reactions that we've had. Shows an attitude that we've experienced throughout, right up including the recent alleged apologies that were made. I think it could have been done entirely better and more effectively on that. But lends me to continue to question whether or not she's the right person to head Noah going into the future on these important issues. But I appreciate everybody that is here today that's going to testify. I want to thank Inspector General Zinser and his team for having done such a good job on this, showing their dedication and their interest in making sure that get to the bottom of a lot of these very important issues. And we're now in the second year of the Catch Here program, and it's really caused a lot of agitation and concern to members of the community. They're enduring numerous challenges and economic hardship. So we know the individual fishermen and their family suffering this, but it also goes beyond related industries in repair and maintenance, in fuel boats, ice and preserve the catch, just to name a few. And I think of just three of those, you know, the Gloucester Marine Railways, Massachusetts Shipyard that used to have 40 boats in its yard at any given time, now has about six. They've been in business since the Civil War. We have Cape Pond Ice Company that started as a Gloucester company in 1848. They used to do 350 tons of ice for the fleet. Now its capacity is down to 200, but they're actually only doing 5 tons for the fleet at any given time. And so those are concerns on that. And third, is a business, is the Gloucester Seafood Display Auction. I think that they've probably, as much as anybody, suffered as a result of the over-regulation of fish stocks, but more so the overzealous action of the Office of Law Enforcement on that. And I know Larry Chulin is, I think, going to testify later today, and I think that we do well to listen to his experience and the company's experience, and people that go there for a fair deal, being able to buy and sell their product, including right through, representatives, if you would, recent appearance by Dr. Luchenko and so-called apologies and reparations on that, I think, would be an interesting discussion. But I know the focus of this hearing is, in fact, the asset forfeiture fund. And we attended that event a little over a year ago when Inspector General Zinser and his group filed a report that evidence and materials Senator Brown was pointing out here, the improper accounting, lack of accountability, the improper expenditures on that. And I think that's been very helpful for us trying to get the most recent audit report that covers that short period of time, as Senator Brown mentioned, but it had weak internal controls. They had difficulties in a number of other areas, as followed by a report last July on the fund. And even then, it found that NOAA had administered the asset forfeiture fund in a manner that was neither transparent nor conducive to accountability, thus rendering it susceptible to both error and abuse. Now, I know they've taken some corrective action. I think, I agree with Senator Brown, I think they need to do a lot more. That's why it's good that you're having this hearing, that Mr. Sinzer and others will be able to discuss just what more they might be doing. But I pose to the Senate panel a fundamental question that I hope they ask today and then delve into a little bit further when you get the documents that they're requesting. Should this funding exist? Should this fund exist, or is it not a perverse incentive for an agency that has shown to be out of control to actually go out and increase its own resources by affecting forfeitures, collecting assets in cash, and then turning them into an asset that they can use in their investigation? Nobody disputes what I think Mr. Schwab said when he talked about people that commit violations should pay for some of the enforcement, not all of them. You can do that. I don't think that's the question. I think the question is whether this asset forfeiture fund has been run so poorly, has been so unaccountable, and has been used as such a vehicle in the way that it has, whether or not we ought to just collect those fines, forfeit the apertures, and turn them into cash, and then put it in the treasury, and have the department come to NOAA every year and get an appropriation for what they want to spend, so that we don't have this perverse incentive out there, and a concern that people are being abused for the betterment of the enhancement of the enforcement on that. Last year, we were trying to give them an opportunity, NOAA an opportunity to clean up their own house. We filed legislation, I filed legislation, that would have done some of that. We've taken away their ability to reward persons, to provide information, leading to arrest, conviction, civil penalty assessment, or forfeiture of property. We thought that was an inducement that might be going the wrong way. It would have stopped them from paying the expenses directly related to the investigation. Again, thinking that that would be a bad inducement for them. We would have left them the ability to reasonably necessarily pay the cost of primary storage for those adders, valid liens and mortgages, claims of parties to properties to be disposed of, and reimbursed to federal and state agencies that they brought on to help. But I think that one or the other, either we take a look and say this fund should exist, and the money should be directed to the Treasury, and people should come in and make sure they get appropriation, or at least limit it so that we take away that perverse incentive for them to maximize the receipts that they get in order to continue on that basis. The other reason the legislation may be warranted on this is the provision we put in that legislation that would allow some of those assets to be spent for reparations and for attorney's fees and costs. Even after the apology of more recent days was made, there's some people that are involved in this do not feel as though they got the reparations they deserve. And certainly, even after reparations, others, they were out of pocket attorney's fees and costs of substantial amounts, leaving them besides the heartache and the emotional trauma and the accident that they've gone through, leaving them with sizable amounts of money that they're out of pocket that impacted adversely on their businesses, but also on their personal life and their family support systems on that. So I would hope that this committee would give some consideration to those aspects on that. And I know that going forward, we have to have a renewed commitment about this asset forfeiture fund and how it's operated, but also about all the other issues of catch shares and reasonable supply enforcement. And I'm glad that you're here. I'm thrilled that you're going to get those documents that we can look into making sure that we get this done thoroughly, completely in a manner that brings some restores some professionalism to the department, hopefully the confidence of the people that are being regulated by the agency as well. I thank both of you again for being here and for doing this work, and we look forward to working with you in any way that we can. Thank you.
I just want to say thanks so much for making the time to join us today. And for right away, that's the statement. Obviously, you spent a lot of time on this issue, you know it all well. We're not going to ask anything else to start. I'd like to ask a question. I just would like to note that my understanding is in the budget submission from Congressman President from NOAA, I think they've asked for additional money that previously they would have used drawn ones from the fund to pay for. And given the new situation that they issued, I think, as part of this ongoing investigation by the IGA, I believe that the number of expenditures which previously had come from the fund, including the purchase of cars, boats, and stuff like that, from now on, basically, you can't do that. And I think that comes from an internal director. But I understand at the same time, the agency will be, instead of taking monies from that fund, will be asking us to consider providing monies to the budgetary